Thank you, Drs. Woodcock and Rogge. I can't think of a better way to outline the important issues that we're going to talk about today and some of the challenges that lie in front of us. Okay, now we're going to move over to session one. Before we do that, there are a few, I see some folks standing in the back. There's a minute or two here that you can find seats. I think that there's certainly an accessible seat here in the front. There's two in this section. There's a couple in front over here. Go ahead and try to find some of those open seats at this time. We are going to transition into session one. Ask our panelists to go ahead and take a seat up here at the table. And as I do that, I'll provide a brief overview of the session. So go ahead. Thank you. This session will address important steps that can be taken in the preclinical space to enable a seamless and successful transition into the clinic, with a focus on how the process of target selection and validation can be made more efficient and predictable. And as both of our speakers this morning highlighted, this is a critical point in making sure that we have the best possible knowledge of targets as they move forward. The session will kick off with two opening presentations. Dr. Paul Morgan, head of translational safety at AstraZeneca, will be the first, followed by Dr. James Barrett, professor and chair the Department of Pharmacology and Physiology at Drexel University. After those two opening sessions, we're going to go right into some prepared comments from the rest of our panelists. Karen Davis-Bruno is Acting Associate Director of Pharmacology and Toxicology at the Center for Drug Evaluation and Research at FDA. Volker Fischer is Vice President of Drug Metabolism and Pharmacokinetics at AbbVie. Pete Hein Vandergraaf is Director of Research, Academic Center for Drug Research at Leiden University. And then finally, Christopher Austin is director, the National Center for Advancing Translational Sciences at NIH. So we'll go ahead and pass over the... Okay, there you go. Thank you. I think you just...
Oh,
I think
that's not the one. Okay. Okay, and I've got my new timer as well, so we should be well set. Okay, thanks very much. So my pleasure to kick off session one, and the brief I've been given is to try and illustrate, if you will, I come from a sort of, you know, drug discovery, early development background, and that's my role, so to try to give a flavor of, I guess, what we are trying to do within industry in terms of optimizing target and compound selection in the early stages, drug discovery, early development, such that we can hand, hopefully, greater confidence and better candidates over to our clinical colleagues for early development. So I've just got one slide to illustrate, I guess, the issue that we know about, and I no doubt will come up in various forms. And that's around sort of candidate attrition. I illustrate this one because, one, it's one of the most recent ones, certainly that I've come across, just appeared in Nature Review Drug Discovery, but also because it actually highlights some of the reasons for early stage candidate attrition. And so really a couple of the points that I would sort of try to draw out of this slide. One is that we need to have a holistic approach in terms of thinking about the reasons for candidate failure, candidate success. And what I mean by that is that if you look at, you may not be able to sort of see that in great detail from where you're sitting, but the panels on the left-hand side, top and bottom, really illustrating the reasons for, across four pharmaceutical companies, the reasons for failure and for candidates that had been nominated before they reached preclinical development, non-clinical toxicology clearly being one of the major ones there. And then as you get into phase one, non-clinical toxicology, clinical safety, and pharmacokinetics are also very important. So in addition, clearly, to keeping a close eye on what are the reasons to be confident about the efficacy of the compound, which will be fully illustrated, hopefully, in early phase two studies, these other factors are important in terms of keeping in mind and for us in drug discovery and early development. So responses from two of the pharma companies, and I guess one of the reasons why I've been asked to give this presentation, I was involved in both these pieces of work in my days at Pfizer, which resulted in the top paper, and my colleague here, ex-Pfizer colleague Piet van der Graaf, was involved in this as well, and then more recently work that was conducted in AstraZeneca. Really all of them are trying to sort of look closely and systematically at our legacy failure and success, if you will, from our portfolios, and try to come up with frameworks by which we would be able to then move forward, learning from that legacy portfolio, frameworks by which hopefully we would be able to improve the candidates and the targets that actually we are selecting, and do that in a systematic way that can be applied across our projects, and obviously within that having mind to what maybe some of the therapeutic and disease area specificities that need to be borne in mind. And why is this important? Clearly, this is just one illustration from the AstraZeneca 5Rs paper. Is the drivers for failure that you see on the left-hand side, as I say, are multiple, multifaceted, and really what this came out with was this framework around the 5Rs: right target, right tissue, right safety, right patient, and right commercial being absolutely core, we felt, in trying to sort of drive this from early stages of target selection onwards. And another factor that was illustrated and talked about in this paper was actually the right culture, and I think Mark sort of got to that in another form of words, in terms of actually having the courage, if you will, to actually make tough decisions around projects, and it's no longer about shots on goal, it's around trying to increase candidate quality all of the way through. So this slide here illustrates certainly for AstraZeneca, and I think other companies as well, what really is the foundation, if you will, for trying to improve candidate quality, confidence in the target, confidence in the molecule that is chosen, whether that be a small molecule or large molecule or nucleotide modality. And hopefully, as you can sort of see here, it really looks at actually a systematic approach to increasing confidence in the quantitative pharmacology and the biomarkers underpinning that project. It covers the pharmacokinetics, the pharmacodynamics, target exposure, target engagement, and ultimately that translation, that traduction to efficacy and safety. And this is the approach that certainly we systematically take now for preclinical, that preclinical data and knowledge that we're developing in the appropriate animal species, and also in the human setting as well. And critically, it's what's the confidence that we can glean in that translation from the preclinical data to the clinical, backed up very much by increasing use of systems pharmacology, PKPD approaches. And hopefully I'll come on to illustrate this. One of the things I was asked to do with in preparation for this talk, coming up with these frameworks is all well and good, and I've been involved in two of them, and other companies have come up with them, but really I was asked, okay, can you illustrate with some case examples how this is actually being applied and within your company? So hopefully in the time that I have, I've decided to use one compound, one project to try and illustrate this, and hopefully this will be a really good case study to have in mind. This project, a very exciting clinical candidate for us in the oncology area for non-small cell lung cancer, which ultimately resulted in the compound. The clinical candidate now is AZD9291. Actually, this project started around about the time that the 5Rs framework was being implemented within AstraZeneca. So I think it's a good example of how to follow the trajectory of this to see how that has been applied. As you can see from the trajectory of this project, it has moved very fast from candidate nomination into first patients dosed, designated in 2014 by the FDA as a breakthrough therapy, and actually the filing is already starting, certainly in terms of the preclinical aspects of it. So a real good, hopefully, case study here in terms of in during a very rapidly progressing project with a very exciting clinical candidate, how at the same time are we able to actually generate the confidence in the data that supports this candidate. Okay, so in terms of right targets, EGFR inhibitors, I guess there were some advantages here in the sense that was a sort of precedented therapeutic target, and indeed there are a number of those which are providing a benefit to patients with non-small cell lung cancer. However, what was known is that there are a number of things. One, increasing evidence of resistance to those inhibitors that were on the market. And I just see that actually the unfortunately the transfer of my my own slides to this has been sort of ruined quite a bit, unfortunately, on the slides. So hopefully I'll be able to talk through the table on the right hand side. Apologies for that. So resistance was something that was an issue, and the T790 mutation was identified as a particular therapeutic target for that. On the left-hand side, you'll see some data in Asian and Western patients that show the percentages of those patients with these mutations. And really, so this program, again, had the advantages, if you will, of having that genetic data, having that patient data around giving confidence in this target. And what hopefully you can see, hopefully online, but we can't see here, is that this table on the top right was showing that actually AZD9721, in comparison to some of the established compounds, had a specific potency for the T790 mutation, and crucially had selectivity over the wild type EGFR, and that was deemed to be important because actually some of the toxicities seen in the clinic, side effects around things like diarrhea and rash with the wild type inhibitors, was something that actually the project wanted to get away with. So they wanted to focus in on the right target, but also try to get away some of those dose limiting toxicities that were seen for some of the more general EGFR inhibitors. And then on the bottom right, you'll see that some of the data from the early studies, which showed that it was active in some of the trials. Okay, so right tissue exposure. What I just wanted to illustrate here was the systematic approach around developing a PKPD model that is important now for all programs, really. And in this one, there was a complication of an active metabolite, so that was incorporated into the PK model. As you can see on the right-hand side, that was shown to be described, the model described the PK well in the efficacy species. That led to actually developing a model around a mechanistic biomarker, again, after single doses on the bottom right. That was predicted well, and ultimately led to the sort of design of a study, an efficacy study, in the most appropriate xenograft model, the H1975, that showed, as you can see, very good efficacy over a long period of time of this inhibitor. And really, this is the type of knowledge and data then could be provided to our clinical colleagues around predicting human dose and PK that they could then take into the clinic. So right safety, this is an interesting one that I just wanted to illustrate. Some data that came out of the kinase profiling for this compound that illustrated that there may be the potential for some issues around insulin receptor affinity, which could lead to issues with regard to hyperglycemia. And systematically, this was addressed with a number of compounds, including AZD9291, illustrating that that actually 9291 was the only one of these compounds that actually didn't, in these single-dose studies in the rat, show a propensity for increasing insulin and glucose. And hence, that compound was taken forward in confidence that that should not be an issue in the clinic. And indeed, that's the way in which it's been illustrated so far. And finally, in terms of right patient, this is some of the most recent data for this compound, again, with patients which have been shown to have the T790 mutation, very exquisite potency being shown for this compound up to date. And as I say, we're very excited about this candidate. So hopefully that's given you a flavor of a case study, if you will, around the 5 R's. One of the things I've been asked frequently is, okay, well, how do you know, or do you have evidence that that actually this framework, if you will, is being successful? And this was initiated probably around about 2012, so probably too early, if you will, in terms of phase two compounds that have come on. There really wouldn't be a sufficient data set. But one area that we have been able to illustrate that is around the area of preclinical safety attrition, where we have a sufficient number of compounds that have come through since the 5 R's were put into place. And as you can see, hopefully, in the bottom right here, comparing the AZ data set from 2005 to 2010 compared to most recent years, a significant reduction in preclinical safety attrition. And that really is because of the other things on this slide in terms of a systematic approach to earlier hazard detection, using quantitative and mechanistic approaches to actually work through the issues there, and at all times trying to give a translational understanding, if you will, around those potential safety liabilities. So not only is this pulling forward some of the studies that may have used to have been, if you will, post-candidate nomination. It isn't just that, such as dog telemetry, but really it's having, as I say, a systematic and mechanistic approach, followed up increasingly, certainly in our company, using systems pharmacology, focusing on preclinical safety as the approach. So this is one area, and we would hope in the fullness of time we would be able to illustrate that there have been improvements in the other areas of the 5 R's when the data set increases. So my last slide, really tackling drug survival, to my mind, requires a systematic and quantitative approach to the key translational knowledge. It is about generating the data knowledge around the best target, the best small or large molecule, and then handing that over, if you will, to our clinical colleagues and working with them around making those decisions based upon data and knowledge early in drug development. Okay, so that's my timer as well, telling me I'm up, and I'll finish with some acknowledgements, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Paul. Our next speaker for the second presentation is James Barrett.
So thank you very much for the kind invitation and for the opportunity to speak at what I think is a very important series of sessions on improving and optimizing drug discovery process. So I'm going to give an overview of some of the principles and concepts in target identification validation, highlighting some of the approaches that can be used, have been used, to increase the success and probability of developing a viable candidate at the end of this. I have one disclosure to make. People typically make disclosures before they give talks. My disclosure is that I'm likely not to say anything novel or new. And a lot of the discussion of what I plan to say will be embedded in my talk, but I'll do my best to emphasize certain key points, which you'll see as we go through this, that they are systems and integrative pharmacology, quantitative approaches, computational modeling, some issues about screens and phenotypic screens, and multi-targeted approaches to these kinds of issues. So here we are. Target identification is the very earliest step in the drug discovery domain. It's very important, and someone has compared target identification to a baseball game, where if you're a good hitter, you typically around 0.3%, 33% of the time you're going to get a hit. Most of us know that it's less than 10% of the time that a drug succeeds as it starts in the early phase. So attention to this very leftward portion of the process here is of vital importance, and the more we can do to increase the probability of success and understanding and process at that point, the more likely it is that at the end we'll have something viable. It's not like a baseball game where if you hit a home run, which is you get a drug on the market, you know you've hit a home run before you get to first base. Sometimes we have to wait 10 to 15 years before we know whether we've hit a home run or not. So it's a very significant challenge. Previous speakers have alluded to the fact that there is a decline in productivity. And this is an article from Sam Stodd that said, drug discovery is at present the art of developing effective treatments against diseases we do not fully understand, using drugs that we don't fully know how they work. And this is a process that continues to be emphasized. And part of the theme that I will address is that for the past 20 years, target-based drug discovery has been the main research paradigm. A number of speakers in the past have emphasized the fact that target-based approach is not an effective paradigm. We need to look at ways in which we can get away from target-specific approaches to more systems and integrated approaches, because diseases are systems processes and we need to understand how the systems work. And this is not to say that target-based approaches are not appropriate or not viable. It's they have their place, and we just saw a good example of how a target-based approach can lead to a drug that was just approved last week. This is from the previous speaker. I want to emphasize the first point, the right target, and the sixth factor, the right culture, that was alluded to very nicely in the previous talk. So what is a drug target? It's a native protein in the body whose activity is modified by a drug, resulting in a therapeutically relevant response. The definition of a target can be relative as well as elusive. The target may be a drug target in one tissue but not in another. May it be a target in one age group but not another, one gender but not the other. We're seeing a lot of gender differences in pain medications, for example. The expression, activity, and structure may change during the course of the pathological process, and quite often many of our animal models in particular don't really address the long-term sequelae that occur in the process of a disease, particularly challenging diseases like neurodegenerative disorders. The structure and function of a target may be altered itself by drug treatment, and likely, the target may not be involved in the disease process, and we'll have certain points there. Most disorders, some myths about drug targets. Most disorders can be treated by focusing on a single target. Simply not the case, particularly in neuropsychiatry. You have a complex disorder like autistic spectrum disorders. You have a complex disorder like schizophrenia, where there are at least three different pathophysiological conditions associated with delusions of grandeur, ideation, paranoia, cognitive dysfunction. The notion that you can have one drug that will target all of those different processes is simply naive, and it's one that we're moving away from, fortunately. Autistic spectrum disorders, you look at stereotype behavior, you look at cognitive dysfunction, you look at social withdrawal, they cannot be mediated by the same process. They simply have to be addressed by multi-targeted approaches. Approaches to target validation and identification are similar across therapeutic areas. They're not. Cancer is very different from neuroscience, and neuroscience is very different from infectious diseases. But one approach is likely not to characterize all. So here is the evolution of drug discovery. Most of the drugs for the treatment of psychiatric disorders, people know, were discovered in the early 50s. We haven't had many new significant insights into the treatment of some of those disorders since 1950, 1960. They were based on clinical observations, which then led to an understanding of what the process is, and we still don't know basically how some of those antidepressants work. We say they work by inhibiting the reuptake of serotonin, but it's likely not the case. Just a few months ago, we discovered that paroxetine has an unknown target. It hits G-protein receptor kinase 2 and is cardioprotective. We never would have known that early on. So we have a lot to understand about the drugs that are currently on the market as well as the ones that are new. So this is the logic of target-based discovery. I won't go through a lot of these because I'm a little concerned about time, but you know, the first step is identification, where you clearly identify the molecular identity of the target, generate data, evidence that modulating the target is validation, selection based on several other considerations having to do with safety liabilities, all of which then give you increasing confidence that the target is reasonably viable and you should prosecute it and throw in these different developments in the drug process. The idea is to minimize risk and increase the probability of success. The rate of target innovation, there are a lot of articles that say we haven't been very innovative. It's not entirely true. This figure taken from Overington shows that there is a high level of target innovation relative to the reuse of established mechanisms in the bottom chart. And you can see going back to the 1980s, a lot of the targets that were identified then continue to be refined in many ways. You have different characteristics in PK, bioavailability, eliminating some of the metabolic factors. But you know, in the top-hand portion of the curve, you can see an ascending limb that's fairly steady in terms of target innovation. The novelty of targets decreases as a function of time and decreases as a function of the phases of drug development. So when the shaded figures show you the number of companies engaging in activities around that target, with the blue being one company focusing on the target and the yellow being five. And so you can see as a target goes through the phases of drug development, other companies jump on it, and it becomes less novel in many ways, so that at the end of phase three, five companies are focused, at least five companies are focused on a particular target, whereas before, only one for the most part. This just appeared relatively recently, showing that the approval of drugs with unknown mechanisms has been pretty steady across the top, across time, shown in the top figure. But novel or other targets, as the previous two slides have shown, are increasing in time. So there is some improvement in terms of identifying novel targets, prosecuting those targets, and developing drugs against them. So some additional information that's gathered during the target identification phase are listed here: distribution in tissues, cell types, biological fluids, understanding homologies with other targets, and species differences in targets. Too many times people have gone forward on the basis of rat data, only to find out that the receptor, the target, the pathway is very different in humans. So the majority of target validations are focused on demonstrating that modulation of that target produces a biologically relevant effect, and ultimately a target is not validated until it's proven in the clinic. One of the big concerns that's occurred in recent years is the fact that two-thirds of the published data relative to novel targets have not been reproducible. This is a significant concern, and reproducibility does not correlate with journal impact factors. In fact, it may be inversely related to impact factors. And venture capital companies say basically they don't believe 50% of what comes out. So the point in the bottom is that the estimated prevalence of irreproducible preclinical research results in $28 billion in U.S. alone of sunk loss costs simply because you can't replicate it. You can increase the probability by having a genetic link. This is a slide from the same article that was just discussed in the previous talk. I'll only say that 40% of the data show a link to a genetic target have a higher probability of continuing along in the pipeline. and 73% of the targets ongoing in successful phase two. So again, the focus on genetic linkage is a very significant endeavor, except in certain complex disorders where you may have 100 or 200 genes, and how do you target those? This is a case, I'll skip over this, where a genetic link to a particular target of an individual who was insensitive to pain led to the identification of a gene, SCN9A, and to a target, a sodium channel channelopathy, that resulted in the identification of a drug. In the last few minutes, I want to talk about phenotypic screening. I mentioned it before. This slide shows you on the lower left-hand corner of this pipeline phenotype-based drug discovery. It was the only way to do drug discovery in the 50s and 60s. There was an Irwin procedure where Irwin, the pharmacologist, looked at the effects of a drug in animal models and could tell you pretty much whether a drug was an antidepressant, an anxiolytic, or likely to be an antipsychotic. So those are phenotypic screens. They aren't used as much these days, but there are some companies that focus on using whole animal models to tell you about drug action. On the top-hand portion of this is target-based drug discovery. And again, you can see the differences in the parallels. This is a slide that illustrates the difference, with A being target-based screening at the top, phenotype-based screening on the bottom. What you need to do after you've phenotypically characterized a particular target is deconvolute that target and identify where the active components are, what they are, and how they interact. It's not unlike taking a natural product and showing some particular efficacy. The countdown is going on, and then identifying which of the many constituents in that natural product may be therapeutically beneficial. So this is just a slide showing that the number of new medical entities is actually larger for phenotypic screening than for target-based screening or biologics, at least for the first-in-class drugs. The follower drugs capitalize on what's been identified with those first-in-class drugs, and so then the target-based screening picks up because you sort of know how they work. 37% of drugs are identified that have been approved as new medical entities come from phenotypic screening, whereas 23% target-based. So I won't spend a lot of time, and again, it's not a better than, it's a complementary approach to identifying targets. I want to say a few things about 1 minute. Biomarkers. I'll skip over this, unfortunately. Go right to polypharmacology, the experimental and computational tools of systems biology, network pharmacology, and chemical biology offer hope that two or more targets can be identified, which when modulated would be predicted to lead to a greater benefit than targeting with a single protein, again, published recently. There are a number of multi-target approaches incorporating systems and network pharmacology. The article that's referred to in the bottom, Systems Pharmacology, an Opinion on How to Turn the Impossible into Grand Challenges, just came out last night as I was trying to put some finishing things, and Morgan was kind enough to incorporate it in the slide deck. But it really gets to the point better than I could possibly get to, and so I'll leave it for you to take a look at. But the point is, few molecules cause disease single-handedly, and few drugs will cure them all by themselves. There are computational approaches which can address the multi-target screening. This is one particular way, using compounds from the FDA database to sort of profile those drugs and to identify multi-target approaches to different therapeutic disease states. And I put this in because I thought it was really good. Richard Elliott said, we're not very good at picking drug targets, and he said it recently this year. Yogi Berra said, we made too many wrong mistakes. The time is just about up, and as Yogi Berra said, when you come to the fork in the road, take it. So I'm going to finish by saying drug discovery and development starts with the identification of the target. There are a variety of ways to validate the target and increase the probability of success. Target-based approaches, along with phenotypic approaches, both provide and will continue to provide valuable information. Most diseases and disorders are complex. Single-target approaches are not always viable or successful. Computational approaches, network biologies, are of growing importance. Complex, heterogeneous diseases require a systems biology approach to understand and then apply effective pharmacology. And I thank you. I was going to talk about pain, but I can probably go
on. Great. Thank you for the two great opening presentations, Paul Morgan and James Barrett. We will transition over into the remaining panelists to give additional perspectives on this topic. And I'd like to just let the rest of the panelists know that, unfortunately, we don't have stairs on this side, so there is a bit of a stage cliff on this side. You are welcome to sort of walk around, and hopefully for the next panels at the break, we might be able to get some stairs over here. So thank you. The next panelist is Karen Davis Bruno.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'm looking forward to the discussions later on. My goal here is to sort of give us an overview of non-clinical studies and what FDA and CDER actually expect. So this is a list that you're probably all familiar with of the supportive non-clinical studies, from the pharmacology safety studies down to the two-year bioassay carcinogenicity studies, and you're all familiar with the timeline on clinical development in the corner. So I won't spend time doing that. But I think it's really important to outline what the goal of adequate non-clinical studies are, and that's to understand the mechanism of action, to establish the dose-exposure-response relationship, to establish the relationship to duration and extent of systemic exposure, identify the target organs, characterize the toxic effects, assess the potential reversibility of toxic effects when needed, extrapolate to potential human risk, which is the big if, estimate safe starting doses and regimens, look at appropriate routes for clinical trials, including the first in human dosing, identify parameters for clinical safety monitoring and guide patient eligibility, and also assist in the management of risk through the clinical development. So non-clinical, just as clinical pharmacology, is undergoing a paradigm shift. It's moving from an observational reactive approach where we do animal toxicity studies to identify mechanistic risk assessment. But what this does is it really selects compounds for safety. That is a no-risk sort of approach. And that limits the number of candidates that we have available for that are selected for future development. And we're moving into a more integrative, predictive, proactive approach, which is focused on, not exclusively, but focused on the mechanism of action using the omics technologies in silico, in vitro, in conjunction with the in vivo. And the idea here, or at least the goal, is to verify and confirm as an approach to risk assessment instead of just to observe. And what we think is that this might actually, the ultimate goal is to manage the product risk in the clinic and beyond. So this changing non-clinical development paradigm, we need to reinforce our knowledge of efficacy, we need to reinforce our knowledge of safety, we need to improve multidisciplinary interactions and crosstalk and discuss advances in technology, such as programs and workshops such as this. And I think it's important that we realize that there's a lot of criticism of extrapolation from animals to humans, but we need to keep in mind that personalized medicine experience isn't ideal either, and that humans don't always predict all the humans because they differ in their exposure to the therapeutics. So we all have to work together on this and sort of do why. And this is a slide you've heard earlier. It's why do we have high attrition rates? Well, it could be that we have insufficient screening for the lead candidates. It could be inadequate clinical paradigms. It could be inadequate predictivity of the proof of concept safety from the non-clinical models, in that we normally use healthy normal animal models for predictivity. And the susceptibility or sensitivity of the model in the patient population may not correlate. There may be comorbidities, such as underlying cardiovascular disease, that aren't readily identified and certainly aren't present in the normal animal models that we use. So we need to customize our tox studies to better address these factors, maybe better use of secondary pharmacology as a follow-up and emphasize this mechanism of action information, use effective management of risk rather than predictivity of no risk, so we don't just select out all the compounds, but we select compounds that we can manage the risk. So we'll have more candidates for development and hopefully less attrition. So this is a very short, very cursory example that I wanted to illustrate some of the concepts that I had. This is a case study with anti-cancer MEK inhibitors. So RAS proteins, as you know, activate signaling pathways that lead to cell proliferation, differentiation, migration, survival, and apoptosis. And so researchers are testing drugs that target the MEK protein, which acts downstream from RAS, and it disrupts cancer cell growth and survival. And so this is a useful mechanism that's being exploited for developing of oncology drugs. So in this case, we know that these kinase inhibitors are sometimes associated with cardiovascular adverse effects despite the favorable anti-cancer risk benefit. So it could be the age of the patient population. It could be the comorbidity risk of cardiovascular events. So the idea here was to use secondary pharmacology, that the MEK inhibitor we know are associated with heart failure. And what I mentioned was that we normally use normal healthy animal models for general toxicity studies, and these don't incorporate the comorbidity factor of concern. So some astute researchers looked at normotensive Wistar rats and treated them with the MEK inhibitors, and they resulted in left ventricular function decrement as measured by echocardiography. But it was a very variable response, and this made looking at the particular drug treatment effect even more complicated. So they decided to look at some alternative animal models, specifically a spontaneously hypertensive rat, SHR rats, which have a decrement in left ventricular ejection fraction at baseline compared to the Wistar. But when they added the MEK inhibitor, the results were robust and uniform decrease in left ventricular function. So they thought that if hypertension might be a precipitating factor for the decrease in LVF that was induced by the MEK inhibitors, they thought if they could control the blood pressure, could they avoid that change in left ventricular failure? And certainly through a series of experiments, they demonstrated that lisinopril, which is an ACE inhibitor, which would normalize the blood pressure in this SHR rats, it definitely prevented the decrease in left ventricular function. So this is an example of how the animal model can help us to manage a potential clinical risk. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Our next panelist is Volker Fischer.
I'm going to talk about how, from a drug metabolism perspective, we can support discovery much earlier. So moving activities earlier, getting the information earlier available, and getting more mechanistic information available hopefully helps us in reducing the attrition there. So PBPK is one of the tools we're using for early mechanistic studies, and that's some technology which was not readily applied for pharmaceutical development. Other areas like safety prediction for environmental reasons was much more ahead of us here. However, with the advent of tools, mechanistic tools like human hepatocytes, recombinant enzymes, and also automation like mass spectrometry, robotics, and so on, that helped readily generate data, which then could be applied to much more mechanistic information, and shifted many of the DMPK activities very, very, very earlier. Another need came up in terms of how do we reduce the number of, for instance, DDI studies, providing a mechanistic understanding as to how you can extrapolate from one DDI study to another DDI study was able to reduce the number of studies significantly and helps in extrapolate from one study to another one. Simcic is a company which is kind of one of the hallmarks. There are other ones around. I listed Simcip here. That company was founded as a consortium and helped really, really build the field there. And as such, then also a lot of consortia and meetings like this here provided the framework in terms of drug transporters, which is similar to the P450s. got the tools to provide the mechanistic understanding to extrapolate one set of data to the other one. But eventually, with meetings like this here, it provided a framework to help the FDA and others to establish guidances. And the first DDI guidance, which came in 1996, and including transporters, came in 2012. And currently, the trend is going to more QS, and the PPK guidance is in progress, as I understand. QSP modeling is something, quantitative system pharmacology is the next step in my mind, and many companies are exploring those if they haven't invested heavily already. So the typical questions, scientific questions we like to address real early, is the right target, the right molecule, exposure, the site of action, target engagement biomarker, and then the functional biomarker and the relevant phenotype. I will go through a few examples how we use those things at AbbVie, for instance. But this is not typical for AbbVie. This is also very much for the rest of the industry, I think. So one of the things in terms of the right compound, one thing we changed at AbbVie was to move things from a sequential approach to a parallel approach. Multiple parameter optimization and balancing potency with the ADME parameters helps save a lot of time, cycle time from when the chemist finds out that's a good thing or not. And it also, by optimizing, getting rid of the discussions for which compound do you need to do which study, you optimize your process to the extent where you can significantly increase your throughput. So for example, prior to this change, as we had there, so we had about 50 assays maybe a week for in different assays for different compounds. Now we're having the 4 or 5 basic assays for every compound which is synthesized, and it's hundreds of compounds a week with the same capacity. So you really significantly increase your number of data. You have more comparable data, and as an end result, this is listed here. The compounds also get into a much better space then. So because you don't always optimize for potency primarily, you can balance those things. So the we get more compounds now in the ideal space, which is in the circle here. Those are data from the literature here. Another example, exposure at a site of action. It was earlier mentioned that we have a very good control of the site of action. I'm not so sure that this is always the case. In many cases, we do. But for instance, if you have a liver target, like for statins or some of the HCV compounds, you have those uptake transporters, which we didn't know a long time ago. But in the meantime, we are aware of those. So the wild-type mouse reflects kind of what, let's say, a human will be. And you have a plasma concentration with the initial fast half-life and then a slow elimination half-life, but so if these are your initial human data, you would think you don't have a high bioavailability, and you think you don't have much of a duration of action because your compound is washed out. But truly, in the liver, which is in many of those things your target, you can have a much more extended half-life. And the reason is the uptake from the blood into the liver will significantly increase that liver concentrations. If you do this in a knockout animal, your half-life, your exposure parallels, your elimination parallels. And then you can use those data to predict your clinical data, and in this case, they came out pretty well. Another example is the right target and target engagement. At AbbVie, we have invested in the Endelar software for rheumatoid arthritis for quantitative system pharmacology. This is just a case example. We modified that software. We implemented the IL-1 beta and the IL-17 pathways, and then we validated the model qualification using literature data. So you can take literature data and the validation. If the ACR20 prediction, they come out fairly well here. And then we apply these kinds of models to then make predictions. And so, for instance, in animals, you would predict the biomarker identification. We would predict that free collagen, free aggrecan, or TIMP1 would be affected by that treatment. That could later on be verified by looking at gene expression data in a DBA mouse and a CIA mouse, and aggrecan, TREP5B, and TIMP1 is again affected. It looks like it's going the other direction, I know that. But what you can tell from those data is that you do see an effect on those biomarkers, which direction and what's the total regulation in the system. That's still a little bit of an open question here. But then in vivo pharmacology is confirming these data, and you see an effect on inflammation, cartilage and bone, for instance. So these are basically the principles how we apply things. And therefore, we can hopefully predict things much earlier and have more a more targeted approach. Thanks.
Great, thank you. Our next panelist is Pete Hein van der Graaf.
Right, thank you very much for inviting me. So what I'm going to do is give you a perspective anchored in from two points of view. One is academic, second is quantitative systems pharmacology, and also the combination of the two. So the academic perspective, of course, how can we in academia partner with you, or maybe in the future even lead some of these elements in drug discovery. So clearly my conflicts of interests are stated here. I make a living out of quantitative pharmacology, but I thought it would be a bit boring for me to just preach to the converted in the next 5 minutes or so. So I'll try to mainly focus on challenges, also because I know this audience will immediately kind of convert any challenge challenge into an opportunity. So this is why we're here: declining R&D productivity. You've seen these papers all before. They keep coming out. Two important points here, I think. One is it seems that the consensus is from these papers and most companies that the main issue is around phase two failure and phase two failure due to lack of efficacy. I think that's by far the biggest challenge and also opportunity we face. Now, I'm going to put this little wooden shoe on the graph here. This is from my predecessors in Leiden, Meiner Danhoff and Douwe Breimer, who presented this wooden shoe paradigm, I think it was about 25 years ago, Carl, at the Noordwijker Hout meeting. And if you can see, the helm here says PKPD. So the idea was that, you know, as long as we let, as long as we drive drug discovery and development with PKPD, we're going to be okay. So my first my first challenge here is actually we seem to lack evidence that that has actually happened. Clearly, the curve that the kind of wooden shoe is sailing upward stream seems to have a pretty kind of constant slope, and I haven't seen any points of inflections yet. I also haven't actually seen a quantitative analysis of the impact of modeling and simulation in the way that Volkert presented on pharmacokinetics, where clearly DMPK quantitative sciences has solved a big issue in phase one attrition. I think we've seen many fantastic case studies, great examples from companies, but in terms of demonstrating that this actually makes the difference, I haven't seen the data. Actually, I was reading the newspaper yesterday, and now the biggest selling drug in the US, $8 billion a year. I was surprised because it came from a company that I would not necessarily associate with being at the forefront of modeling and simulation. Now, that could be complete chance, but it's food, you know, food for thought. So we made an attempt at Pfizer to kind of address this issue, at least with our internal portfolio. So what you see here is a paper from Pete Milligan and Rick Lalonde and Pfizer colleagues, some may be in the audience here, which was a follow-up paper from 5 years earlier, how model-based drug development had impacted Pfizer's portfolio. And the other point of the paper was that now model-based drug development had moved very much from the scheme to the right, late stage, to kind of earlier modeling and simulation applications. And you can see that arguably, there had been a very positive impact since the implementation in 2005 on phase 3 and phase 4 survival. The green curves go up. However, you can also see that actually, if anything, the phase 2 green curves stayed constant at best, or maybe kind of even went down slightly. That could be because we became more critical at, you know, what was a phase 2 success, etc. but certainly no evidence here that model-based drug development had tackled the biggest issue that we're facing, namely phase two attrition. Second analysis that Paul already spoke about was the three-pillar analysis, which looked much more at the kind of earlier PK/PD understanding and the correlation with phase two failure. And I think the paper made a very compelling quantitative case that lack of PK/PD understanding was almost guaranteed to be associated with lack of phase two success. The opposite actually hasn't been demonstrated yet, and my former Pfizer colleague Pinky Jua recently presented an update of the three-pillar analysis at a QSP conference in Basel, and obviously I no longer have access to the data, but her conclusion was that at the moment it seems like there is no evidence that implementation of the three pillars has worked. So what can we do? Thankfully, I think we still have the biggest opportunity untapped. So if we think about confidence in proof of concept, you could argue that's a combination of the confidence in the compounds, that's PK/PD, that's the three pillars on the left, but also obviously confidence in the targets, and that's the focus of this session. Clearly, you're not going to be successful in phase two if you pick the wrong biological targets or the wrong patient targets, and that's really where systems pharmacology comes in, pathway modulation, pathophysiological regulation, and disease modification. I counted because we moved from three pillars to the five R's, so now we have six building blocks. And if you do the math, if you do the math on the sequence 3, 5, 6, you can figure out what the next number is, 6. So you can work it out yourself. So this is the ultimate number, I think. So what is systems pharmacology? It's something like a hybrid between pharmacometrics and systems biology. I think very importantly, in my view, it's kind of a spectrum of activity, but the most important thing is it explicitly contains mechanistic biological elements and integrates that into PK/PD models. So Paolo Ficini and I published this commentary a couple of years ago, Systems Pharmacology, Paradigm Shift or Flash in the Pan, and our conclusion was, well, we can't tell yet, and I think that's probably still the case. And I'll now move on to my list of challenges. So I think the real issue around QSP that it makes a tremendous lot of scientific sense. It's a very compelling idea that this may actually improve R&D productivity, but there's some significant challenges, and I've listed a few here. So the first one is really, so why, what, and when? And I'm not going to spend too much time on that because that's a big topic. But clearly, stating the obvious that you need to know what your question is and what your model is actually going to have for kind of impact, because that will also relate to the scope of the project and the timing of it. Now, thankfully, in most cases I talk to pharma teams, it seems like they have figured out the question pretty well, but I also come across examples where if you ask this question, why are you developing this model, says, well, just because we can, we're just going to build a big model, and then lots of goods will kind of follow. I think that's a recipe for disaster, both in terms of impact and also timing, because timing, of course, is of critical importance in pharma R&D. So that's my point one, and then I'll focus the rest of my few minutes on the how, where I have listed four items for discussion, hopefully at a panel discussion, the round table. Training and education, new data requirements, model validation, and collaboration. So I'll just have one slide on each briefly. I can still do that, can't I? Okay, so training and education. So here's a survey that was done a few years ago by PricewaterhouseCoopers, who asked pharma leaders, so what is the talent gap that you foresee in 2020? And it's difficult to see on this slide, but by far the biggest bar was biomedical engineers. So pharma leaders and HR people worry about the fact that it's going to be very difficult to find biomedical engineers. So we need to start to train these people. Obviously, that's something that academia needs to do, and that's something that we and other centers are now focusing heavily on, for example, by starting a program on mathematical pharmacology. I've also listed some vacancies, current vacancies, all around computational approaches in our center alone. That's about 10. We are struggling to find people, and it's really a plea here that we need to work together. looking at the indirect model of kind of talent, I think currently our K out is bigger than the K in, and you modelers know that leads to a decline in the baseline. Data requirements, I think we need new measures of biomarkers, not necessarily ones that give us immediate clinical efficacy guidance, but give us guidance on pathways, because that's what we need to focus on. For example, in our center, we focus heavily now on integrating metabolomics and PKPD. Also, I think what we need to do is to start to focus more on what we've called biomeasures. So these are measures of the system, like, you know, expression levels, turnover rates, etc. Very often lacking in when people are trying to build QSP models. Validating system pharmacology models is extremely challenging. You see some comments here on how to do it. I don't think we actually know how to validate these models. The only thing we know is it's very different from classical statistical pharmacometrics models. The graph at the bottom, very interesting, is work on model reduction we've been doing. And this is recent work from a PhD, Tom Snowden, who basically showed that we can collapse a large system pharmacology of the NGF pathway, which has some hundreds things in it, to 8 states, and actually the performance is identical. So it kind of shows that we're over-parameterizing these models mathematically. Actually, that could be the way biology works, and that's very intriguing and gives us a lot of insight in, for example, combination therapy. Final point, you see the end. We need to work together, really, on model building, on database generation. Here's an overview recently published in PSP of diabetes models. You can see that I think there were some 700 papers that the authors found on new diabetes models. And per year, I think there's some almost 100 papers now. That's a waste of time, I think. It clearly shows that we should be better working together, also in the context of making public databases. And that's certainly a recent paper from the FDA has shown an example how we can do that. With that, I close my talk and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Our last panelist for this session is Chris Austin.
Okay. I'm going to take a little bit of a different tack and try to tell you one of the things that we're thinking about at NCATS that really fits our mission and that I hope will help in what we were talking about this morning. That is, NCATS has the privilege of working on what we like to think about as exponential or transformational approaches to these kinds of problems, which I think, as you've heard from Janet on forward, have been have had some headway made on them, but they remain at least difficult, if not intractable, in many cases. And so the way we approach this in terms of general principles is everything we do is a collaboration with someone. We're big believers that, as has been said by many people, much is known, but unfortunately in different heads. I love that quote from Werner Volath. We also focus on demonstrated utility of whatever we create, utility to other people who are working in this space, not just us. And at NCATS, we're working across the spectrum on these problems, the kinds of problems that we've been talking about this morning, all the way from target validation to implementation research. But what I'm going to tell you about today is just one project, because I think it's an exemplar, which I think will give you hopefully an idea of a novel approach to this kind of problem, as well as the way that we approach these translational problems in general. So this program, this tissue chip program, which I'm going to tell you about briefly, came from the realization that we all have been dealing with in our careers of the difficulty of predicting efficacy or toxicity of a novel therapeutic. The fact that the success rates in toxicity are about a flip of a coin. It's about 50-50 animal data predicting human data, and efficacy prediction is even worse, as we know. So So we thought, well, gosh, one could lay a lot of this failure at the feet of, or the paws of, if you want to put it that way, the paws of the animal data or the animals, because, of course, humans are not animals. So would it be possible to develop a microfluidic homunculus, essentially, is what we're trying to do here? That is, instead of doing a reductionist approach, we actually have a separate reductionist approach that we're doing with FDA and EPA and others called TOX-21 on this problem. But as another approach to this problem, could we make multicellular human organoids, which would represent a critical structural and functional features of human organs, and thereby using human cells model safety and efficacy. So it's a very ambitious project, but it's exactly the kind of thing that that NCATS and NIH in general, I think, ought to do. So we started this about 3 years ago now, so it's a very early effort. But I want to tell you that this effort has been more successful more quickly than I anticipated. I must tell you that though I was a fan of this project in general, in terms of its goals, I was a skeptic in terms of its ability to actually deliver. And I was at least... up until this point, I appear to have been unjustifiably skeptical. All of these projects are run as milestone-driven go-no-go decision projects, and they're very heavily project managed, and every one of these projects is ahead of its milestones. And if you ask, well, why is that? I think it's because of this phenomenon of convergence that we're seeing in multiple areas of translation. That is, this is a convergence of microfluidic technology, IPS technology, biosensor technology, and bioengineering, tissue printing. So just very quickly to run through this for you, how we're doing this is to create initially 10 different physiological systems representing these tissues here, which are the targets of xenobiotic toxicity. And these had to be modular. They had to be built in sort of Lego brick form so that they could be mixed and matched going forward, so we didn't have the VHS Betamax problem, for those of you who remember that. And they had to be viable for at least a month. And if you can imagine keeping these multicellular organoids together, operative and non-contaminated for a month without pen strep, that's not trivial. So here's the organizationally how the program works. It's a collaboration. Remember, I said that everything NCATS does is a collaboration. This case, it's a collaboration between NIH, NCATS in this case, DARPA, which is the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, and the FDA. And increasingly, we have industry partnerships that are coming in to help us validate these. If you're interested in the project, there's actually a video on our website. This individual who describes this is yes, we named him Chip, and he will tell you about all this. So how this works is that we start up with a scaffold, generally extracellular matrix, add cells that are generally stem cell derived. They have to have a certain structure. They have to have a certain spatial and temporal patterning. Sometimes the cells acquire that themselves. Sometimes we have to give it to them. They often have to be perfused, because remember, these are multicellular aggregates that have to be alive for a period of time. They have to be in a bioreactor that keeps them alive. They have to be innervated in many cases, for instance, in the gut. We actually have a gut a chip, which actually is innervated with enteric nervous system cells, and actually it peristalses on the chip. Often have to have a host response, particularly in studying toxicity, because this is where a lot of the toxic response come from. They have to have a non-destructive functional readout and a computational design to gather all these data so that we can model the data that comes out of it. This is a very large collaboration, sort of flower model of this. It's jointly managed by NIH, FDA, and DARPA, and all of the little petals here are different academic investigators who developed initially single organs and increasingly integrating those organs into two or three organs together now. And they're, in addition to the NIH effort, which is the petal here, these two large petals on the right here are engineering efforts funded by DARPA as part of the project. And I'm just going to show you one. This comes from Lance Taylor at University of Pittsburgh. This happens to be the liver construct, because I thought it would be particularly useful. I think one of the things that which has been a lesson for all of these programs is that you don't get normal function no matter how hard you try with single cells. You really have to have hepatocytes, the matrix, stellate cells, endothelial cells, and Kupffer cells all present in order for any of those cell types to opt to behave normally. And this happens to be cytochrome C release when exposed to nafazidone. And to give you a sense, I'm not going to go through these data, of course, but just to give you a sense of the kinds of things that we're doing, that we're creating these to have multiple biosensors incorporated into each of the chip platforms so that one can look at multiple readouts depending on the output that one's interested in, but also not have to predict a priori what the compound is that you're studying you think is going to do, because, of course, you don't know before you test it. So it has to be sort of phenotypic screen, if you will. These are some data simply showing some early data on validation of the liver platform. We're doing this in all of the organs. If you just see it from the back of the room, you'll notice the drugs, which go from least to most problematic in their liver toxicity. And you'll notice that on the very far right side, you'll see that in the chip, on the liver chip, you get more greens at the top and more reds at the bottom, so correlating with the clinical outcome. So where we're going here now is we're integrating each of these organs. So the story that I showed you in liver, I could tell you about any of the other organs, heart, kidney, et cetera, bone. And we're aiming for all of these various readouts on the right and others, and in many cases are already there. But of course, they have to be correlated with the in vivo responses, which ultimately we're interested in. We hope that within the next 5 years, and assuming that I think we'll get there if we stay on the current trajectory, we'll have all 10 tissues integrated on a single microfluidic platform that, for instance, allows you to infuse a drug in artificial blood into the artificial gut. It'll get absorbed or not, go to the artificial liver, get metabolized or not, then go to the artificial kidney and cause tubular necrosis or what have you, or not. And the great thing about this is that you can, of course, introduce compound or withdraw a sample for LCMS or whatever one wants to do at various stages here, because one can create ports in such a system, which from a biomedical engineering perspective is actually quite simple, but you know, in a mouse is not so simple. And the other thing that I just want to sort of leave you with is something we're really beginning to think about actively now is, well, because each of these is made on the basis of iPS cells, one doesn't have to have a generic human on a chip. One can make a chip from each of you in this room and then look at individual efficacy responses or individual toxicity responses. And we're currently planning combining this program with another NCATS program, the CTSA program, to actually do a parallel clinical trial, clinical study in humans and on chips made from those humans to see what that correlation is. So just to finish here, there are many partnerships. This is not just us alone. It's DOD, it's FDA, GSK particularly has been an early adopter here in providing compounds that failed human testing. But the IQ Consortium, who co-sponsored this meeting, is deeply involved in this project, forming a scientific panel to help us make these relevant, providing compounds and providing input on marketability so that they can be made available broadly to anybody who wants to use them. And we're always seeking new partnerships, so let me know if you have ideas. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. So we're going to jump right into the question and answer session. I see that there's a microphone up here. I think there's one more in the back. Maybe we can put it over on the left side, since it's sort of hard to get around. While you all are thinking, and I can tell from the body languages I've been watching during these discussions that you all are really engaged, and I know you have questions for these panelists. A lot was presented, so I want to encourage you to go ahead and come up and ask your questions. While you're doing that, I do have a question for the panelists more generally. We heard phase two failure rates due to lack of efficacy is a big challenge. It seems to be one of the most challenging areas, and one of which that should be addressed with some of these tools. And Janet's charge to this panel was to figure out how we can do a better job of getting target selection and validation much earlier on. And as I've been watching the presentations from a science side, translational PKPD, systems pharmacology, this polypharmacology approach seems to be where everybody is focused. But I want to sort of hone in to the panelists really quickly on that sixth R. Which is the right culture that came up a couple of times, and I think that means sort of culture within the company to make tough decisions, but also to engage in more collaborations. And I'd like to ask the panelists, what will it take to get a company or multiple companies to sort of change culture and engage more in these collaborations? So any takers for that one? Pete, I might call on you. You sort of mentioned collaboration in your...
I don't work in a company, so I have no idea. No, I think culture is extremely important, particularly in systems pharmacology. I think I think everyone agrees that that is really not a single individual or a single discipline that is driving that. It really can only be done by linking different disciplines, modelers, biologists, clinicians, and you can go on together. And I think that needs a cultural change in many organizations, because it's maybe not something people are used to.
Great, thanks.
I would just add one thing about that. Before I was at IH, I was at Merck for many years, and I've seen both sides of this, and I think from our perspective, one of the reasons that collaboration is so important to us is that from our point of view, our pharma colleagues bring the kind of bottom line, is this useful, is this addressing a current problem perspective, but from their perspective, we bring a de-risking ability. That is that we're bringing funds and people to take some of the heat off of them, because they're at a very high stakes game. And so if we can do this jointly, then we're able to decompress some of the risk aversion by taking some of that risk onto ourselves.
Great, thank you. Paul, did you have?
Yeah, I mean, certainly in terms of the right culture, I mean, I've experienced it real time, if you will, with the five R's. What it takes, it won't be a surprise to you, is that courage, or not just of the sort of the people bringing along the projects, but actually the senior leaders, if you will, who are in some type of governance setting, to actually take this seriously. And I've seen that sort of happen real time, and it does take courage for a project that's invested quite a lot of time, effort, and resources to come along and to be told that you need to sort of stop and go away, either stop the project or go away and generate more compelling data. That gives confidence that this is a candidate or a target that can be supported. But I think that's happening, not just within Z, I think other companies. The collaboration bit, I think that's really working very well at the technology level, and I think that some of the things that Chris has talked about in terms of generating newer and better technologies which have the potential, I think maybe the challenge for us is actually at the therapeutic level and the disease level. Are we actually collaborating enough there around new paradigms?
Great. Quick.
So quickly, I think one of the slides that was emphasized so clearly to me was a long-term vision. And I think it's often the case that there are only short-term visions where you're looking at the next quarter earnings, and or the CEO is telling you, I need six compounds by the end of this year, and what you'll get are six compounds with varying qualities. But I also think that collaboration is extremely important as well. But it's the ability to create and sustain a long-term vision that I think has been important, a success in many of the existing pharmaceutical companies.
And then Volker, I think you have something, then we'll go to our first question.
Yeah, so collaboration in terms of the PPPK, for instance, that's relatively straightforward because there is no, there's a common interest and there's no proprietary stuff in stake versus collaboration on system pharmacology, for instance, when we try to collaborate across industry, usually it's the question what's competitive and what's pre-competitive, and people don't want to release their data freely. Yeah. I think that those are some of the issues.
But I think that is a cultural problem, not a scientific one.
It's maybe a legal, cultural.
Well, yeah. That's cultural. Yeah. That's cultural.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Thank you for that. We're going to go to our first question. Just quickly, your name and affiliation.
David Barron, PKD Foundation. I'm interested in the notion of organs or systems on a chip. Other than liver and skin, many organs contain upwards of 40 to 50 different cell types, and those really cannot be replicated, at least not in the five-year time frame that you're talking about. And that combination of some subset of those 50 cells in, say, the kidney or the lungs may be used for a very particular disease entity, and if IQ and industry come up with a common organ on a chip and that gets validated, then what happens to the specific chips that are really innovative that deal with specific diseases and rare diseases when the FDA may be more comfortable with what the NIH has come up with as the model for a three-cell system representing liver?
Yeah. As in developing any technology, you want to start with the simple ones and demonstrate that you can do it in those systems. So, so with apologies to the safety folks in the room, yeah, we did consider liver one of the simpler ones compared to the CNS, for instance. But what's interesting is that So I guess I'd say two things. One is that what we're trying to do is demonstrate a principle, first of all, that some of the really complicated physiological responses can be modeled in an in vitro platform, and if so, how. But we are then assuming that this, and hoping that this will lead to an entire field of sort of personalized chips, if you will, depending on the kind of reaction or the kind of output that one is interested in studying, one will have to make a different kind of multicellular organoid system. The FDA has been a critical and integral partner in this from the beginning, because the whole idea has been that they would develop initially expertise internally and then guidances on how to do this in real time as the project is going forward. So the great thing for them about this is that they see all the good, the bad, the ugly, the dirty laundry, everything from the beginning, and it's actually making them much more comfortable with the process because they understand what the limitations are from the beginning. We are working on more difficult problems as we go forward. Interestingly, we now have a female reproductive system on a chip, believe it or not. We do not have a male system on the chip, however, so we'll hopefully get gender equity at some point here. But and also looking at metastasis in an in vitro system as well. So more complicated systems than I would have anticipated.
Great. Thank you. Question on the side?
Yes, thank you. Ann Bonham, Association of American Medical Colleges. And Chris, in thinking about now that we've come to grips that sex is a biological variable, have you thought about the donors for the organoids for the chip on beyond the female reproductive system and before we get to the personalized chip?
Yeah. So this is the sort of LC part of the project, if you will, the ethical, legal, social implications part of the project. That yes, whose cells are they that are going on to these initial chips? It's sort of the same problem we have with the genome project, right? Who do you sequence? There is a whole process of consent that's going on for the cells that are put onto these chips. It is particularly important because one of the mandates of the program is that by the end of the five-year period, these will be commercializable platforms. So you will be able to buy them from somebody who makes them.
So are you looking at the sex of the
Is that the question? Oh, yes. And because as you know, our experience, I am continually astounded by how different the responses are in what we tend to think of as non-sexually dimorphic organs, like the kidney, for instance, dramatically different between the two species.
Two
sexes. Freudian slip there, sorry.
Next question over here.
John Burke from Applied Biomath. First of all, I'd like to thank you all very much. I really enjoyed your presentations and talks, and I think there'll be a lot of good discussion following from them. My question is, you know, to Paul first and then the rest of the panel. In your presentation, I really liked how you used modeling to understand, you went through it very quickly, the EGFR, insulin, IGFR type dynamics to accelerate and make decisions for your program. One would argue, myself included, that you increase your return of investment to do that as early as possible, potentially at new target stage, where you can bring in your clinical pharmacologist, where you can bring in marketing and say, what's your TPP? How often do you have to dose, right? Is this a chronic indication? Do you have to do monthly subcutaneous dosing to be competitive 5 years from now? And for the examples that you talked about and others, you can make pretty simple models. Like with yours, you can have the turnover of the receptors, how long it takes them to become reactivated. You can put in the cell cycle arrest. You can figure out it's a Cmax system, and you might want to dose twice a day. You could have done that much sooner. So now one can imagine that as an engineering approach, biological engineering or biomedical engineering, as it's done in circuits or in aerodynamics with the Navier-Stokes equation, you can perturb or systematically change your model parameters from a mechanistic point of view to very early on identify knowledge gaps, prioritize experiments, and identify at least hypotheses for optimal parameter ranges for your drugs. So you can have an optimal drug much sooner. So when you get to phase one, phase two, phase three, you can have much better clinical study designs and whatnot. And you know if you fail, it's because of efficacy and not because of the molecule or anything else. Here comes my question. So I found when I was on the industry side, it took a lot of effort to change research management to allow clinical pharmacology, to allow toxicology, to bring marketing early on to do this. Eventually you see, they want that. And I'm finding it very difficult now that I'm trying to impact multiple organizations as a consultant. And I was just wondering, how are you using these approaches early on to make best-in-class molecules as early as possible? And how are you bringing this pull of clinical pharmacology early and modeling as soon as possible to make these decisions? You know, is it working, not working, and maybe, you know, what's your advice? Thank you.
So just one brief point on that is that, so I think that, you know, the systems approaches that you're talking about, absolutely, and I think Mark may have alluded to this as well, is that I think we're on the cusp of the curve with that, of sort of seeing that start to yield. So I would say absolutely, certainly in our company, and I know in others, you know, those systems approaches are becoming much more fundamental and being built from the start. I think, you know, the benefit that we've had so far around modeling and simulation really has been around, you know, if you will, not so much ad hoc, but opportunistic, you know, use of systems pharmacology, PKPD modeling to help get better data and knowledge out of the study. We're moving now to the systems approach. I think it's too early to declare success on that, but absolutely, you know, systems biology and systems toxicology. I had an example, I couldn't get to it, around a very neat, you know, example that we have around using a systems tox approach. Bringing clinical data and also, you know, omics data, et cetera, around that. The challenge then will be around actually, one, that takes a lot of effort, a lot of expertise. This is where collaboration comes in. No one company can have all of this expertise in its own company, so collaboration is crucial. But it's also having the courage to make some real decisions around that. But I think we're close to it, I would agree.
I think it's the culture thing. It's getting the heads of research to buy into this. That can be tough.
I agree. Yeah.
Great. Next question. We are sort of running a little bit over time, but that's okay. We'll do sort of rapid fire question.
Sure. Joe Mulcosky, American Association Colleges of Pharmacy. I want to come back to the collaboration and culture theme that I'm seeing, and all of you are demonstrating it by being at the same table. So I think we have a perfect opportunity to think about the workforce needs, because the students we're training now are NIH-funded training grants, where medicine is going to be going, where graduate education, pharmacy is going, interprofessional education is on the table. But I also think we have this dialogue ongoing across the country to sort of revise and renovate graduate education and postdoctoral training. So please don't leave this very innovative discussion out of thinking about how should we train our workforce for the future. And Chris, thanks for showing off Pittsburgh. I'm emailing Lance as we speak.
Oh, good.
That's an extremely good point and one worth following up on after today. Question?
Marcel Hope, Genentech. Let me ask a provocative question. This is really a nice overview of everything that is going on in more the early stages and what we can do to address attrition and increase productivity. But again, let me actually challenge you for a second. So are we really addressing attrition, or are we just moving it around? So to give you two examples. So in the case of Paul Morgan's talk, he kind of showed that the attrition due to safety after introducing the 5 R's, it's actually reduced. But that's by doing some of the tox studies earlier on. And on a kind of more therapeutic area, are we simply now better in explaining why compounds fail? And so again, are we just moving attrition around, and are we just taking the attrition earlier? But attrition is still attrition. So are we truly better at predicting success?
So attrition is one, if you want to, you know, is one parameter to keep an eye on. But I think much more fundamental, what I was sort of trying to get across was increasing the confidence in the knowledge and the data that we have, backed up by quantitative approaches that we can actually provide to our clinical colleagues, and to sort of say, okay, you know, here is a reasonable basis upon which you can take this target and this molecule into, you know, I think that for me that's much more important than frankly tracking, you know, if you will, where our attrition. So I think you're right. I mean, there's a lot of this is around where we're doing a lot more earlier. And you could say pre-candidate, before it actually sort of gets to any other organization, we're taking the attrition. But if in doing that we're, as I say, systematically increasing the confidence around those decisions and the ones that do go on to clinical development, then those guys, you know, have much more confidence in addressing the you know, the key question and the hypothesis, then personally I think that's the right way to go.
Can I just answer that? Because it was kind of the point I was making in my perspective. And so I think we need to be very cautious about kind of linking, you know, systems pharmacology to failure. I think it's actually very easy to predict outcome. I mean, my model is everything fails, and then I'm 80% of the time I'll be right. That's much better than any other approach. So I don't think also culturally that's where we should be, and that's also why we need to start very early. Because I think to me, systems pharmacology is not about target identification; it's about target validation. And it's really about, you know, finding points in networks is really system, you know, systems biology. But then it's up to the pharmacologist to say, you know, how do you want to modulate? How much? And with an antibody or a small molecule? And those are very positive ways. We could actually say, you know, a small molecule idea maybe not so good, but an antibody could work. I think that's a much better place to be for systems pharmacology than just kind of being the doom and gloom sayers of R&D.
Great. Last question.
I'm Carl Peck, UCSF and NDA Partners. This is just a comment, and it's a comment on our first speaker. I don't know if Janet is still here, but if she's not, if you wouldn't mind passing this on. I don't think I've ever heard such a perfect articulation of the value and role and potential opportunities of the breadth and depth of clinical pharmacology in drug development and regulation as I heard from Janet, so please pass that on. I do have one minor criticism, though. She sort of identified the RCT, the randomized controlled trial, as a problem. Actually, I love the RCT, and I think most clinical pharmacology studies these days are done in randomized, blinded, controlled fashion. And that's a huge strength. But it's what we do with the final phase three clinical trials that is limiting. We insist on a frequent test of only one pre-specified hypothesis, which is actually very simplistic, and missed the chance of utilizing the prior information, and I'll be commenting about that later in the day, to enrich our learning and confirming from the phase three trial.
Great, thank you. That was a good point, and so just to reiterate, it's not necessarily that the trials themselves are the problem, but I think what Janet was saying is to get better opportunities to supplement that information, to get some of the earlier preclinical and then earlier clinical information up to the point of decision to help fill some gaps. So great, thank you. I'd like to thank all of our panelists for great presentations, a very, very helpful discussion that will definitely set up the stage for the rest of the afternoon. We are running a little over, but we will say at 11:20, we'll get our session two panelists up here at the table and ready to begin. Thank you.